serve così tanto, sempre l'onore della sua presenza, come consueto non c'è bisogno di presentazioni per il professor Carver, che è un specialista di molte cose e che ha segnato veramente la storia della filosofia moderna negli ultimi 30-40 anni, quindi in molti sensi è un maestro, credo, gran parte dei presenti, quindi è veramente una gioia averlo qui ed è una gioia ancora più grande sentirlo parlare, almeno per me, di Leibniz e di un tema che è stato importante nelle sue ricerche, cioè quello della dinamica, il progetto della dinamica e il rapporto tra questo e la messa fisica. Lascio la parola e lui grazie.
Grazie anche per l'invitazione di parlare qui. I'm always very happy to come to Lecce. The theme for these seminars has been force and power. And given that, I think there is no more philosopher of the period that is more appropriate than Leibniz. Arguably, force was at the very center of Leibniz's thought, both about the physical world and about its metaphysical foundations. In one of his programmatic essays, De Pura Philosophia in the De Notiona Substantiae, published in 1694, Leibniz wrote, and this is the first quotation, T1, on your handout. The concept of forces or powers, for whose explanation I have set up a distinct science of dynamics, brings the strongest light to bear upon our understanding of the true concept of substance. In the following year, in his Specimen Dynamicum, also published in the Octave under the term, Leibniz argued that force, and not Cartesian extension, is what is found at the foundation of things. And this is quotation C2. In corporeal things, there is something over and above extension, in fact, something prior to extension, namely that force of nature implanted everywhere by the Creator. In my talk today, I would like to discuss Leibniz's project for a science of force, his science of dynamics, and the metaphysics of force that he formulated in connection with that scientific project. And what I want to do is give an overview of Leibniz's career, the development of his concept of force and the science of force and the metaphysics that is connected with that, from his early years up until the very end. Starting in the late 1670s, Leibniz argued strongly for the rehabilitation of substantial forms and the recognition of corporeal substances, bodies unified by these forms, as the fundamental constituents of the material world. For Leibniz, the substantial forms seemed to be able to ground the forces that he had discovered, which lay at the foundations of his newly developing dynamical physics. But at the same time as he was working on his dynamics, Leibniz's thought was also going in a somewhat different direction, toward a world composed at its root of genuine unities. At first, this other metaphysical view seemed perfectly consistent with the dynamical metaphysics, indeed complementary to it. The active corporeal substances that the dynamical physics lead us to appeared to support the other metaphysics as well, a view of the world composed of genuine individuals. But I will argue, as Leibniz's thought evolved, the two programs came apart. The pre-established harmony between the dynamical world of forces and the world of unified individuals eventually turned into disharmony and dissonance. The crucial moment, I claim, was in 1695, when monads first emerged in Leibniz's thought. Part of my story is that, and I will be telling a broad story about Leibniz's development, is that monads do not appear in Leibniz's thought until somewhere midway in his career. So let me begin with some remarks about Leibniz's previous views of the physical world. Leibniz's earliest physics, and here we're talking about 1669, 1670, 1671, just before he went to Paris in 1672, Leibniz held a Hobbesian physics of purely inert bodies, where the only activity and force was motion. Following the physics of Hobbes's De Corpora, Leibniz held that, quote, whatever is at rest is always at rest, until it is hit by another body in motion. Whatever moves always moves with the same speed, in the same direction, unless it is prevented by another contiguous body. From this, Leibniz drew an important conclusion, one that Hobbes had also drawn. Quote, rest is not the cause of anything. That is, a resting body does not give either motion or rest, direction or speed to another body. And so body at rest offers no resistance to acquiring new motion. This conception of body and its physics persisted from Leibniz's first speculations about motion and impact in 1669 until the end of his Paris years. But in the summer of 1676, just months before leaving Paris for Hanover, there's an extremely interesting and important change. The new perspective is found in an essay that Leibniz sketched called De Arcanis Motis et Mechanica Autorum Geometricam Geometrium Mercantum. In this essay, Leibniz emphasized, and this is T3 on her handout, that just as the first axiom of geometry is that a whole is the sum of its parts, the first axiom in mechanics is that the equality or equivalence between full cause and entire. A clear consequence of this is the conservation of force or power, the ability a body and motion has to do work. To take the example that Leibniz uses in that essay, the force or power possessed by a body of size m and speed v is the height to which that body can raise itself through that motion. One important consequence that Leibniz drew from this new conservation law was the necessity to deposit resistance in bodies, even bodies at rest, a radical change from his earlier physics, where the only forces were actual motions. So at the end of the De Arcanis Motis, Leibniz wrote, and this is T4, unless a body were to resist, perpetual motion would follow, which violates his conservation principles. Since a body resists in proportion to its bulk, since there is no other factor that would limit it. In this way, the De Arcanis introduces two forces into Leibniz's world. The force associated with motion that's conserved, that's the force that allows a body to do work, to raise itself a certain height, for example. And a passive force of resistance. So there are two forces associated now with bodies in the after the De Arcanis. A force associated with motion and a force associated with resistance. At the time that he wrote the De Arcanis Motus, Leibniz thought that the quantity conserved was identical with the Cartesian quantity of motion, size times speed. The next step in the development of his science of motion is found in the manuscript De Corporum Compulsum, January 1678. In this seminal text, which was masterfully reconstructed and analyzed by Michel Pichon, Leibniz comes to the realization that the active force that is conserved, the ability to do work that a body in motion possesses is measured not by the Cartesian quantity of motion, size times speed, but by size times speed squared, mv squared. And this, I think, marks the beginning of the dynamics problem, the beginning of a science of force. The basic strategy of argumentation found in these early texts is also found in the Revestan structure of 1686, starting with these Fieber controversy, which was the last long after Leibniz's death. The Revestan structure, of course, is the first publication of a piece of the dynamics program, but its genesis goes back to this period, 1676, 1678. Though supplemented and perhaps displaced by an a priori argument and the notions of actio and effectus, there are still these same arguments and the same approach is still very much present in the Foranomus and the Dynamica, which are the first attempts to systematize the dynamics of the late system. The argument to the effect that mv squared is conserved, that Leibniz gives in 1678, and again in the Revestan structure of 1686, assumes the Galilean law of free fall. So it does, it is an a posteriori that depends upon certain conclusions about the physics. In the late 1680s, this represents sort of the next stage, is when it is that he attempts to give a priori evidence for the same conclusion, but I'll talk about this in a moment. These discoveries in physics had important ramifications for Leibniz's metaphysics. In an outline for a book consolidating these new discoveries, a text that the Academy editors have named the Conspectus Libelli, Elementorum Physica, 1678-1679, Leibniz wrote, and this is T5 on the handout, there follows now a discussion of incorporeal things. Certain things take place in body which cannot be explained by the necessity of the matter alone. Such are the laws of motion which depend upon the metaphysical principle of the equality of cause and effect. And that's the principle that he discovers in our times. Therefore, we must deal here with the soul and show that all things are elemental. And I'll leave that last sentence out for you. At roughly the same time that he wrote the Conspectus Libelli, Leibniz wrote it to his employer, Duke Johann Friedrich, quote, I re-establish substantial forms with demonstrative certainty and explain them intelligibly. What Leibniz suggested here is that the laws of motion, which depend on the principle of equality of cause and effect, could not be explained unless there were forms in bodies. Leibniz was somewhat cryptic about this question in the passages that I quoted, but it isn't difficult to figure out what he meant in mind. Earlier, I noted a piece from the late 1670s let me turn to a piece from the late 1670s that can be called the De Legibus Naturae, the Laws of Nature, in which Leibniz argues for the necessity of resistance in bodies. And Leibniz wrote, and this is T6, over and above that which is deduced from extension and its variation or modification alone, we must add and recognize in bodies certain notions or forms that are immaterial, so to speak, or independent of extension, which you can call powers, potentia, by means of which speed is adjusted magnitude. These powers consist not in motion, indeed not in conatus, but the beginning of motion. Those are Hobbesian terms. But in the cause or that intrinsic reason for motion, which is the law required for continuing. Resistance here seems to be conceived of as a kind of activity. But activity cannot be derived from bare extended matter, or from motion, which is just change of place. It requires something distinct from that, something from which activity can be derived. This is what Leibniz calls form, soul, or pose. For Leibniz, then, the conservation principle entails that there must be something in body over and above extension from which resistance can arise. But so does the force associated with bodies in motion. You remember the De Arcanis, the view of the De Arcanis requires two forces in bodies, one associated with resistance, the other associated with actual motion. But actual motion also requires a certain metaphysical conception of body. And this is from section 18 of the Discours de la Physique in 1686, T7. For if we consider only what motion contains precisely and formally, that is change of place, motion is not something entirely real. But the force or the proximate cause of these changes is something more real. And there is a sufficient basis to attribute it to one body more than to another. Now this force is something different from size, shape, and motion. And one can therefore judge that not everything conceived in body consists solely in extension and in its modifications, as our moderns have restrained ourselves. And of course, he's referring here to Hobbes and to Descartes. Thus, we are once again obliged to reestablish some beings or forms that they have vanished. And with this, we have a second physical argument from force for putting forms in bodies. In both of these arguments, the assumption is that force, both the passive force of resistance and the active force, resides in substantial form, which Leibniz thinks of as the seat of all force and activity. By the mid-1680s, though, this metaphysics changes in a subtle way. Leibniz came to distinguish the active force, the vis agenti, associated with motion, from the passive force of resistance. The former remains in the substantial form, while the latter is now put in matter. Acting and resisting each have their own kind of force, one associated with form, the other with matter. In this way, with the reform of physics comes a reform of metaphysics. Just as understanding the importance of the notion of force leads to a proper understanding of the laws of nature, it leads as well to a proper understanding of the notions of body and substance. Let me return now to the passage from the Conspectus Rebellion, and this is T5. There follows now a discussion of incorporeal things. Certain things take place in body which cannot be explained from the necessity of matter alone, such as the laws of motion, which depend upon the principle of equality of cause and effect. Therefore, we must deal here with soul and show that all things are animate. Now we can read that last sentence. Without soul or form, some kind, a body would have no being, because no part of it can be designated, which does not in turn consist of more parts. Thus, nothing could be designated in a body which could be called this thing or me. And this alludes to another theme in Leibniz's thought in the 1670s, the importance of unity and individuality in connection with the world. The worries about unity and individuality that ultimately lead Leibniz to revival of substantial forms in physics seem first to arise in some reflections on views like Descartes, for whom matter is indefinitely invisible. Leibniz's first thoughts on this question involve physical atoms. And I think he was originally attracted to the Cartesian atomism of whom he met in Paris. But the metaphysics of body that we will later see in the 1680s emerges from the Paris notes when he realizes that what he needs is not physical unity, hardness, or indivisibility, but metaphysical unity, that is, genuine metaphysical individuality. And this transformation seems to have been made by the time of the Inspectus Labelli, T5. It is obvious to Leibniz that there is something wrong with the world in which all there is extended and infinitely invisible body. That's to say, Cartesian bodies. Leibniz's worry here is articulated in a fragment from 1682-83, where he sets out his worries as an argument. And this is T8 on the handout. One, step one, I suppose that one has no greater unity than logs in a bundle of firewood, or a log pile, or bricks placed one on top of the other, is not properly one entity, but rather entities, although one name can be supposed for all of them. Two, I also suppose that nothing is intelligible in a body other than extension. Three, finally, I suppose that every body is actually divided into several parts, which are also bodies. And from this it follows that either bodies are mere phenomena and not real entities, or there's something other than extension in bodies. The idea here is very simple. The reality of a pile of stones derives from the reality of the individual stones. If each of those stones were itself a pile of stones, and so on to infinity, then there would be no reality in the entire thing. You need something to ground the reality of a collection of things. And indivisibility doesn't give a sufficient ground. What seems to save the reality of the material world for Leibniz is form or soul. As he writes in a fragment contemporaneous of the Inspectus Labelli, substantial form or soul is the principle of unity and duration. In particular, the genuine individual that will ground the reality of the physical world will be a union of body and soul that constitutes an animate creature, what he will call corporeal substance. As he writes in another fragment, dated from 1683 to 1685, and this is T9, unless it is animated or contains within it a certain single substance corresponding to the soul, which they call a substantial form, or primary intelligence, the body is no more one substance than a wood. And with this, we have a second motivation for reviving substantial forms in the late 1670s. The need for genuine unified individuals to ground the existence of the material world. So let me take a little bit of, take a little review of where we are now. By the late 1670s and into the 1680s, Leibniz had two distinct kinds of argument that seemed to lead to largely the same conclusion. Both need the need to introduce force into the world through his dynamics program, and the need to ground reality in unity and individuals seemed to lead to the reintroduction of substantial. The two kinds of argument, to be sure, do attribute two substantial forms to different functions. In the case of the dynamical arguments, forms are needed as they around the courses. In the case of, for arguments from unity, they ground the unity of corporeal substances, which are the true individuals that populate the world. But even so, Leibniz must have felt very much encouraged by the fact that these two very different arguments seem to lead to the same conclusion, which is the revival of substantial cause. Now, in the years that followed, Leibniz developed both the metaphysics that grew out of the dynamical project, a metaphysics of force, and the metaphysics of unity, an infinite number of corporeal substances, each a body unified by the soul. In 1689 and 1690, the dynamical project was enriched by the composition of the four nomos and the dynamica. But in addition to the technical elaborations and the introduction of an a priori argument for the conservation of energy square. Not clear that that's exactly what it was, but there was an a priori argument added to the Galilean argument that we used the dynamical metaphysics was also elaborated. Interestingly enough, this didn't happen in the texts where Leibniz was developing his technical work in the dynamics. But in 1693, he had written to a correspondent, Jacques L'Enfant, that, quote, "I cannot see how one can find there, as to say, in substance, anything more primitive than force." In the following year, he published the essay De Prima Philosophiae Mendatione in the Acta Politorum, where he claimed, and this is T. Monday, the quotation that I gave at the very beginning of "the concept of forces or powers brings the strongest light to bear on our understanding of the treatments of substance." Leibniz made the contributions of the dynamics to his metaphysics clearer a year later for the publication of the Speculum Dynamicum in 1695. And now we are at 1698, which is, I think, a crucial year for Leibniz. So the Speculum Dynamicum, which he published in 1695, is a summary of some of the main themes of the Four Nomos and the Dynamica. Though interestingly enough, the main new technical result expressed in these words, the a priori approach to force, is almost entirely missing in this text. It is very ventured and it certainly is not developed. What is new, though, is the elaboration of the larger metaphysical framework. In the Speculum Dynamicum, Leibniz offers a detailed development of the dynamical conception of body. And there he presents a fourfold hierarchy of forces. And this is T10 on your hand, distinguishing between active and passive, primitive and derivative. So you have now a total of four different kinds of forces. Primitive, active, and passive force, and derivative, active, and passive force. The distinction between active and passive forces, and within these forces, between living and dead forces, for derivative active force, and between impenetrability and resistance, and passive derivative force. That distinction is not new. But the distinction between primitive and derivative, not to be confused with active versus passive, is relatively original for the Speculum Dynamicum. Derivative forces are just the variable forces that appear in physics. Primitive forces, on the other hand, are that in bodies which ground the derivative forces. So, quote, "primitive active force corresponds to the soul or substantial form." And, quote, "the primitive force of being acted upon, the vis primitiva patiendi, or of resisting, constitutes that which is called primary matter in this force, if correctly interpreted." So Leibniz in the Speculum Dynamicum interprets primitive active force as substantial form, as primitive passive force as matter, material. And this then is the conception of the body. Primitive active and passive force, that is form and matter, the stuff that grounds the variable magnitudes of active and passive force, which are the subject matter of physics, properly speaking. So Leibniz sees himself, or represents himself, as rebinding the Aristotelian conception of body in terms of matter and form, but now interpreted in terms of active and passive force, the subject matter of his science and dynamics. That's what happens now on the side of the dynamical conception. The dynamical alongside the dynamical metaphysics, Leibniz continued to develop the metaphysics grounded in conceptions of unity. And this is most evident in the 1680s in the important correspondence with Arnauld, in which Leibniz develops the metaphysics of unity at greatest length. Focusing on corporeal substance, the unity of soul and body that constitutes the genuine individual in Leibniz's thought. At the same time as Leibniz is publishing the De Prima Philosophiae Enigmatica and the Speculum Dynamicum, he is also working on an essay that will give voice to the vision of unity that had animated his correspondence with Arnauld. And so in 1695, the very same year that he published the Speculum Dynamicum, Leibniz published the Systematicum. The conception of substance found there is pretty much exclusively what I call the metaphysics of the unity. At the end of the first part of the Systematicum, Leibniz wrote, and this is TLM, there are only atoms of substance, that is, real unities, absolutely destitute of parts. This is the unity, which are the source of actions, the first absolute principles of the composition of things, and as it were, the final elements in the analysis of substances. We could call them metaphysical points. They have something vital, a kind of perception, and mathematical points are the points of view from which they express the unity. Only metaphysical points, or points of substance, constituted by forms or souls, are exact and real. And without them, there would be nothing real, since without true unities, there would be no knowledge. And this is the pile of stones that I referred to. Clearly, it is unity and not force that is at issue. But Leibniz insists, that the real unities that appear around the world are absolutely destitute of parts, and that they appear to be something distinct from corporeal substances. About the same time, two new words enter Leibniz's vocabulary, simple substance and monad. In an unpublished note, probably written in 1696, a reply to a critique by Simon Pouchet of the Systematicum of Evil, Leibniz writes that, quote, in actual substantial things, the whole is a result or coming together of simple substances. And from that moment on, I mean, you can find two or three pieces of simple substance earlier, but not in this sense. And beginning and with this occurrence, simple substance becomes one of the central technical terms in Leibniz's. The term monad appears for the first time in a letter to Gauthier, dated 12-22 July 1695. Quote, the key to my doctrine on this subject consists in the consideration of that which is genuinely a real monad. Within a few years, it is clear that we are in a different world. in a famous passage written by Richard Holder, 30 June 1704, by the Secretary, and this is P12. Indeed, considering the matter carefully, it should be said that there is nothing in things except simple substances, and in them, perception and act. And here it is clear that we are dealing with a world whose ultimate constituents are simple, non-extended, mind-like substances, the familiar moments of our mind. Starting in 1695, the metaphysics of unity thus evolves into the one another. Corporeal substances, bodies unified by substantial forms and souls, are replaced by the monads as the basis of reality. But what becomes the dynamical metaphysics of force that have been so prominent earlier? We follow the dynamical conception of body and form and matter, understood as primitive active and passive force, up to the mid-1690s, for the spectrum of dynamica. But what becomes of the dynamical metaphysics after one night's course and 1690? Here the story gets somewhat different. Let's consider first the treatment and the correspondence with the Holder. In the letter of 20 June 1703, Leibniz attempted to explain to de Volder his new monadological conception of the world. The monad, Leibniz tells us and tells de Volder, is composed of a primitive intelligent, substantial form, joined with a primitive passive primary matter. This, of course, recalls the vocabulary of the spectrum and dynamics, and the dynamical metaphysics, of course. However, the primitive forces are identified here not with constituents of body, but with constituents of non-extended monads. This then is what he has to say about extended bodies. This is T13. But in the phenomena, that is in the resulting aggregate, everything is indeed explained mechanically, and masses are understood to encompass one another. And in these phenomena, nothing is needed except the consideration of derivative forces. Once it is agreed where they result from, namely the phenomena of aggregates of the reality of aggregates. Bodies seem here to be aggregates of moments. And while we find the primitive forces in moments, we find the derivative forces in bodies, which are understood as aggregates. And this is T14. I regard the substance itself endowed with primitive active and passive power, like the eye or something similar, as the indivisible, that is the perfect monad. The forces that arise from mass and speed are derivative and belong to aggregates, that is the phenomenon. And indeed, derivative forces are nothing but modifications. Shortly after comes an often quoted passage, T15. I therefore distinguish one, the primitive intellige, that is the soul, two, matter, namely primary matter, that is primitive passive power, three, the monad completed by these two things. So primitive, the soul and the matter are now make up for the mass, that is the secondary matter, the organic machine for which innumerable subordinate monads come together, and five, the animal, the corporeal substance. The dynamical conception of body and the corporeal substance enters into the discussion in the correspondence with the Bose as well. Now I'm moving a few years ahead. This is the correspondence with de Volder. With de Volder is very interesting. De Volder looks at this stuff and can make no sense whatsoever. The correspondence ends abruptly. De Volder just throws up his hands because he cannot understand what life is. But the issue taken up again in Leibniz's correspondence with Richard, with DeVos, but in a rather different way. In a letter of 15 February 1712, Leibniz introduces his famous vinculum subtilis, that by means of which aggregates of monads are somehow magically transformed into corporeal substances. In the course of that discussion, Leibniz turns to the status of matter and form in the corporeal substance that the vinculum creates. So you have monads that are pulled together by this metaphysical glue, the vinculum substantiale, that makes them into a genuine substance. How do you think about matter and form then? 16, this is T16. From the union of the passive powers of the monads, there in fact arises primary matter, which is to say that which is required for extension and to living, that's to say, or for diffusion and resistance. From the union of the monadic intelligence, on the other hand, there arises substantial form. So we have all of these monads coming together to form a corporeal substance. Each of them has a matter and a form. And from the union of the matter of the monads that make up the substance, we get the matter of the substance, the corporeal substance. From the union of the forms in each of the monads, we get the form of the corporeal substance. But, he continues, that which can be generated in this way can also be destroyed, and will be destroyed with the cessation of the union, unless it is miraculously preserved by God. However, such a form then will not be a soul, which is a simple and indivisible substance. So we still have matter and form, now in the monad, that are reflected in the corporeal substance. But we have something that looks like a soul, but isn't really a soul. Something that looks like matter, but isn't really matter. And this is interestingly different from the view that we have in the older correspondence. Their primitive force is in the monads, and derivative force in their aggregates, which are phenomenal. But there are primitive forces both in the monadic and at the corporeal level. Both the matter and the form are duplicated. Furthermore, in the corporeal substance, and now we're talking about the view in the DeVos correspondence, the form is not a soul, strictly speaking, not a single substance, not a dominant monad. It seems that there is primitive force, active and passive, both in the monad and in the corporeal substance. The forces in the latter arising from the forces in the former. Derivative forces, interestingly, are not mentioned at all. The doctrine of the vinculum substantiale gets considerable development in the succeeding letters between Leibniz and DeVos. And Leibniz's view evolves in an interesting way over the course of the exchange. In the last letter Leibniz wrote to DeVos, dated 16 May 1760, fit over 4 years later. And this is just maybe 6 months before Leibniz dies. He writes, and this is T17, I do not say that there is a mediating individual between form and matter, but rather that the substantial form itself of the composite and the primary matter taken in the scholastic sense, that is the primitive, active, and passive power, belongs to that bond as the essence of the composite. The bond, the glue, that pulls together the monads to make the corporeal substance, is now the subject of the active and passive force in the composite. But, interestingly enough, it is not clear that the monads contribute anything at all anymore. Leibniz continues in the next sentence. This is still T17. However, this substantial bond is naturally and not essentially a bond, or requires monads, but that does not involve them essentially. So you can have the bond, the glue, without the monads. And the glue, the bond, has the primitive active and passive force. Right? So it does not involve them essentially, since it can exist without monads, and monads without it. If I read this right, the substantial bond does not require monads. And in a later passage in the same letter, Leibniz seems to indicate that the composite substance doesn't require monads either. This is T18. The composite substance does not formally consist in monads and their subordination, for then it would be a mere aggregate, that is, an accidental being. Rather, it consists in primitive active and passive force, from which arise the qualities and actions and passions of the composite, which are perceived by the senses that they're assumed to be worthy. The composite substance does not formally consist in monads and their subordination. Okay, at this point, interestingly enough, Leibniz may be back where he was more than 20 years earlier in the articulation of the dynamical conception of body in the speculum dynamic. The composite substance is grounded in primitive, active, and passive force, form and matter, which exists in the substantial bond. But the substantial bond exists independently of the world of monads. The substantial bond in this way seems to be a bond no longer. Most surprisingly, the monads seem to have dropped out altogether. I don't want to suggest that this is Leibniz's final judgment on the matter, but nevertheless, you never want to suggest about any message that this is Leibniz's final view on this, because it's always rethinking things and changing his mind. But it is interesting that he considered it at all. Okay, so where are we now? I think that this last bit of the story from the metaphysics as it evolves after 1695 is a very interesting story. At the moment, at the end of the 1670s, when Leibniz claimed to revive substantial forms, it looked very much as if his two metaphysical projects, the one deriving from his newly articulated dynamics, and the other from his conception of unity and individuality, were marching together, two faces of a single program. But as the metaphysics of unity evolved into the monadology, this isn't so clear. I talked about a couple of attempts Leibniz made to integrate the dynamical metaphysics of force, active and passive, primitive and derivative, into the world of monads. And he obviously tried to. And he was still committed to the science of dynamics. He was still committed to this fourfold division of forces and the metaphysical implications. There are other texts still, and other attempts to merge the metaphysics of force and the world of monads. In the end, I think Leibniz wanted to keep both of the programs, both the metaphysics grounded in unity and the metaphysics he thought he needed to ground the dynamics, the science of force. But in the end, it was an uncompleted project. Though he attempted to figure out how to put the two pieces together, I don't think he ever arrived at a solution that satisfied him. And so in the end, the two projects were seen at first to complement one another, eventually to apart. And in the end, it isn't easy to see how the ultimate reality could be both forces, as the dynamical picture holds, and at the same time, the non-extended mind-like moments. Thank you very much. Thank you.
anime della riflessione di Leibniz sulla dinamica e sul problema dell'unitare, sono semplici, sono difficili da integrare e anzi producono dei problemi ancora maggiori delle ultime riflessioni. Abbiamo molto tempo per le domande.
Abbiamo deciso stamattina di fare l'intervento di seduta all'altro.
Ah, perfetto, allora
ci sarà una discussione plenaria.
Benissimo, allora cambiamo le sedie. Thank you.